Good morning, everybody. Happy Monday. We have an amazing show for everybody today. Marshall Kosloff is in for Krystal Ball. It's good to see you, Marshall. How are you, my man?
I'm really good. I'm excited to kick off Monday with everyone here. Let's get into it.
Let's do it. Okay, so we got some really great topics for everybody today. First of all, for the guests, you got a guy, Jacob Hellberg. He just wrote a book about China, how the U.S. should respond in terms of technological warfare and more. Obviously, it's very timely given all the stuff that's going on with Taiwan. We're going to delve into all of that. Matthew McConaughey breaking his silence in terms of whether he's going to run for the governor of Texas or not. It's an incredible interview, but it actually says a lot about our current political moment. We're going to dive into all of that. New York City is nuking its gifted and talented program. A lot of hot takes. Both sides, we're going to delve into what exactly is happening, whether it's a good decision, bad, what are the justifications and why you should care. Is it coming to a school near you? Facebook whistleblower, we've got some more follow-up on some interesting things going on with her, and really just what is the broader conversation? Should we even care about Facebook, period? Economic shortages, something you guys know that I care a lot about, but we got to start with the very, very top line of what's happening, which is the horrific jobs report that happened for the Biden administration. So let's go ahead and put that up there on the screen. September job creation came in short with just 194,000 jobs. So just so people know, that is horrific. They were looking for something like 700,000 to 800,000 jobs is what the number needed to be. Now, the real issue is that once you start going in and looking at what's happening, the unemployment rate still stands at 4.8%. This, of course, comes at a time when, you know, the unemployment benefits have expired. 4.8% actually isn't terrible necessarily in a normal economy, but the targeted areas of unemployment, Marshall, are where it's a total disaster. So even though leisure and hospitality did gain net jobs, the unemployment rate, though, for the sector is still 7.7%. And then professional and business services, it's the same thing. So when you go and you look sector by sector, very critical places, leisure, hospitality, and more, it's pretty clear that the Delta variant in September in particular, just put a stranglehold on the entire economy. And this is what's dragging Joe Biden down. I mean, everything that we've seen so far, he barely had a 50-something percent approval rating whenever it came to his handling of the economy when he came into office. Now he's in the sub, you know, 30s, 40s, something like that. This is absolutely what will drag him down. It was the only area where Trump was ever outperforming him throughout the entire general election. If this doesn't turn around fast, it's gonna be a big problem for him.
Yeah, and I really like how you laid out how many different interlocking parts are coming together here. The narrative that's been disproven, and you and Krystal did a great job of covering this, was last month, a lot of people said, well, with the unemployment expansion, insurance coverage expansion coming to a close, people were going to go back to work.
Yeah, that worked
out. Guess what did not happen? Yeah. Now, that's not to say that the policy should have continued. That's not to say that everything was working perfectly. It's just to say that anyone who's coming to you with a very convenient, very easy story about how the economy is reacting to COVID, the Delta rise, all these interlocking factors, how individual states are performing, how individual cities are performing, how individual employers are performing, is just not going to be selling you an accurate bill of goods.
Yeah, it's really, let's put a Washington Post tear sheet up there on the screen. This is actually very important. So the key takeaway is that we have an extremely uneven and bumpy recovery. I like the way that Heather Long put this, which is that some people say they'll go back to work when they feel safe and well compensated. So actually, one of the biggest problems, Marshall, that has happened here is that the conventional narratives around what happened just all don't seem to make any sense whatsoever. Everybody, and I really mean everybody, in the conservative movement said that when these unemployment benefits expire, we are going to see a mass rush to jobs. Guess what? It just literally did not happen. In fact, we saw a retraction, or at the very least in the sectors where this was supposedly impacting, we didn't see any growth whatsoever. So what's the answer? And this is something that I've been saying over and over again, and I know it doesn't make economic widget sense, as if people are widgets. Some people just don't really like the job that they used to do. And it turns out, after a year and a half, people go, hey, you know, driving for Uber, that sucks. And no matter how much money you're gonna throw at me, all your fake little bonuses, I do not wanna sit in a car and drive for 13 hours a day and only make like $60,000 a year. That's just not gonna work for me. Same thing whenever it comes to dining, right? I've talked to a lot of the waiters. I've just been like, hey, how's it going? They're like, hey, you know, like, I'm doing this because right now, you know, we're making a lot in terms of tips and the restaurant raised its wages. But, you know, a lot of people say, I just don't want to go back, especially in non-metro areas. Guess what? Waiting for tables, that sucks too. Ask anybody who works in the service industry. They hate it. And especially in terms of the tip minimum wage, now we've had an option, or people have seen a different life at a year and a half out of the market. They say, maybe I'm going to go back to school. Maybe I'm going to go do this. Hey, I met my cousin and he's got a shop or whatever who does this, and I just don't want to do it anymore. And that is the problem, which I don't think that can be solved. I don't think it's a policy thing. You know, you and I were talking this morning. It turns out that when you shut down the global economy for a year, some really crazy stuff happens. This is one of them.
And I want to pick up on the point you just made about shutting down.
Right.
The key thing here is I know a lot of people are probably reacting thinking, see, this is what happens when blue states shut down. This is what happens when Joe Biden puts in a vaccine mandate. Something that you and Krystal should cover later in the week is this whole story about the Southwest Airlines and like possible strikes that could be happening. The point is, all of these things are coming together. And even without a vaccine mandate, even without a mask debate, even without whatever California or New York or DC are doing, there's all these things that are coming together. And another part of this data that's so interesting is the fact that there's this white collar, blue collar divergence here when it comes to coming back to work. For you and I, we have these white collar professions, we're in media, this is really great. Right. We're very flexible, we're doing everything remotely. But if you are the type of person, this was covered in some of the Washington Post reporting, there's this guy who used to have this really awesome job where he would install alarm systems in old folks' homes and old folks' houses. He really enjoyed it, he liked talking to people, and he's saying to himself, I can't have that job anymore. That job collapsed. I don't want to just go work in retail right now. And even without the unemployment expansion, he is just going to continue trying to find something that really fulfills him. So trying to have a system where people can feel like, hey, can I find work that's fulfilling to me? Can I accomplish what I'm trying to accomplish in my life? Has been a really important point. And that is the part that no policymaker, Democrat, Republican, local, national, has anything to do with.
You can't fix that. Exactly. It's like people have had a great reassessment of work, of life. You know, I've been recently talking to people, the amount of mobility in terms of moving would defy the mind. Now, you would think, oh, but it's a pandemic. No, a lot of people had a lot of assessments and saying, you know, I don't want to live here anymore. I'm going to go live somewhere else. Obviously, those people were privileged and they had the financial means to do so. But I'm just giving you an example on the highest end of the scale of the income spectrum. On the low end, it's, I don't want to work this job anymore. I want to go do something else. Hey, I don't really like this. I like spending time with my kids. Or I want to spend more time with my kids because I actually had to work conversely more. You know, I mentioned that the unemployment rate actually declined. But one of the problems, I want to make sure I shout this out here, is that the reason why is not for a good reason. It's because the labor force actually shrank, which is that the amount of people who were actively looking for a job declined by hundreds of thousands. And a lot of it was women. A lot of women in particular just said, you know what, I don't want to work anymore. You know, they were mentioning childcare. Mm-hmm. They're not even necessarily the cost. They're just saying like, look, I like spending time with my kids. There's nothing wrong with that whatsoever. But that's going to have a lot of economic outsized factors. Matt Brunig, who has been hammering this point home for a long time, let's put this up there on the screen around unemployment benefits. This was the worst month of job growth since the Biden administration became president, and the second worst since May of last year when the pandemic labor market recovery began. So as he points to, it's not like the unemployment insurance cuts did not work, or the unemployment insurance cuts squarely did not work. As you said, look, should unemployment be that high all the time? That's a debate. You know, not necessarily in terms of the incentives or whatever, but in terms of the idea that everybody was making more on unemployment, and thus that's not why they're not going back to work at Jamba Juice for $7.25 an hour. This has pretty much just been explicitly disproven. Same whenever it comes to restaurants. We had a full month now where a lot of this stuff has not been there, and we haven't seen any recovery whatsoever. If anything, we've seen the opposite. Let's put Heather's tweet up there. She also did a great sum up, which is that the key takeaway is that the Delta variant obviously took a toll because hotels only added 2,100 jobs in the last month, which is horrible considering the baseline on which they started. Unemployment aid was not the big factor holding people back. labor force participation is weak, childcare obviously weighing on the ability to work. And actually, I think this is where the schools start to come into play.
Yeah.
Because even though the school system is back, just speaking with Krystal, I mean, you know, some kid 9 seats away sneezes and has COVID, and then, oh, the whole, everybody's got to go home. And apparently, by the way, they require these expensive PCR tests, which it's not like you have to pay for it, like not somebody else. So you got the cost, you've got, there's a sheer amount of chaos whenever, which comes with little children, and he's got to get out for 2 weeks, and now he's back in, and some kid on the soccer team, you know, over there sneeze, and he's got COVID. So apparently that's a whole thing. That level of chaos in young kids' lives, that just flushes right up in terms of the parents who said, you know what, I can't deal with this right now. I got to focus on making sure that, you know, my kid is eating 3 meals a day and being able to go to work. So I think you put that all together, and like I said, it's going to look, at the end of the day, Joe Biden is the president, and no matter what, he's the person who's going to have to, quote unquote, take responsibility for this, even though I personally think these are all just massive macro forces which are in and out of his control. To the extent of his control, it's marginal. You can't force somebody to go back to work.
See, here's the part which is difficult for me, and I don't actually know how I feel about this long term. As you said, there's all these macro micro forces combining themselves together. The thing that's driving the unemployment issue, it's these spikes in COVID.
It's
the COVID spikes up and down. And look, like at the end of the day, like I hate to sound like that super conventional wisdom person, but the US does have some of the worst spikes in the entire world. So it's not as if there aren't lessons we could take from other countries, especially in Europe, who are doing a better job of managing that part of the pandemic. Like once again, like a dynamic and a conversation we're having with people is people say, hey, like why did Joe Biden aggressively put down this mandate? Whether you support the mandate or not, what's clearly driving him is the fact that they have calculated a better risk to take is that people will be ticked off by the mandate than allowing COVID to continue to spread. And the part that if I'm Joe Biden and I'm that administration that I'm thinking about now is if this is happening at the end of summer, what is COVID winter going to look like? The prediction I'll make that I'll probably have to eat is just that, you know, if this will probably be like another winter where there's just very, 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 very aggressive spread. So the question is, what are they going to be able to do in the months before then to actually restore trust and address some of the problems that you're describing there?
My hope is that September was a high water mark, that Delta was so infectious. I mean, I got infected, I got COVID. And that enough people now have both vaccine immunity and natural immunity such that the winter surge won't happen. That being said, there's still 68 million people who haven't been vaccinated. And in terms of the amount of that population which hasn't had COVID, it's just, you know, it's larger. And that means they'll have clusters. You'll see the same thing that's happening across the American South. So, look, I don't know how it's going to shake out, but the key point is that COVID is putting a stranglehold on the economy. And at the very same time, when you shut people out of work for a year, some crazy stuff is going to happen. And that's what we're seeing manifest in the jobs report. All of that politically, not good for Biden.
Hey guys, thanks so much for watching.
That's right. Just as a reminder, you can become a premium subscriber today. Watch the full show completely uncut. Our reactions to each other's monologues. You get to listen to it. You get to ask us questions. All that good stuff. Link is right there in the description or at breakingpoints.com.
Best of all, great way to say screw you to the mainstream media.